others, and therefore kinds of suffering of others, and therefore it is, you know, great compassion, universal compassion, right? It's even compassion to your enemy, compassion to the cobra, compassion to Hitler, compassion to whoever it is, even Monsieur Putin, compassion to him after the bombing of the very, we must very much have compassion for him ordering the destruction of the and his own son. They really making bad, bad barrier between themselves and relativity and entity because of their fear that will arise and kill so many people. And even though they ordered others to drop the bomb, they get the worst of it. So then how much you, so then a Buddha is someone who has managed to melt totally into all of relativity. That's the Dharma kind, that indivisible from Sambhava kind. And you only can do that when you realize, when you give up fear and you realize that completely melting and giving yourself away, in a sense, before realizing it, you're giving yourself away. And so when you give it away, then that's blissful. And then the intensity of that bliss enables you to give it ultimately and totally. So people who go around saying, I realize emptiness, are unfortunately misguided. And because their I is kind of gone. And on the other hand, you know, that they will, you will know them by the way they behave. And they will be totally very impressive. So, like his mom. But he won't say, I realize. Now and then he can say, oh, I had a little hint, you know, a little electricity in my heart. After many years of bugging him, he'll say that. But they say, oh, I'm bad yogi. You know. He won't let the scientists measure his brain. But he says, I'm no good. You have to go measure good yogi. He always says that. So on this mountain, then, they say that the Buddha, when he was a little older in age, although they consider that second wheel of Dharma, the three wheels of Dharma, the first is Four Noble Truths, and the second one doesn't contradict Four Noble Truths, it just goes deeper on the self-aware and you know, on the more immediate presence of Nirvana, non-dually. Four Noble Truths, he allowed the people who were listening to stay with some of their reification habit, their intrinsic reality habit, where they thought that really this is samsara, that's horrible, and there's a really nice nirvana I want to go somewhere else. And he let them do that because they wouldn't have been able to handle the idea that this right now is nirvana. They would have either thought nirvana sucks, so no point worrying about it, or they would have thought that I can do whatever I like because it's nirvana, so I don't need to do anything. So one or the other would have been harmful to them, so he didn't teach them that. And but he told him the Four Noble Truths, that realistic worldview is the first of the part of the path. And that's why I'm always bothering you guys about working critically on why you have been acculturated and why you believe that culture by the way you plan for the future, that you won't have a future life, that you're only you in this life, your body-mind complex in this life, which you are not. You are more than that. That's your temporary configuration of you, but you're way more than that. You have beginningless being, endless being, and actually you're one with Buddha from a realistic point of view, which is Buddha's point of view. Our view is unrealistic, but we think we're very different from Buddha. So that's why I'm always bugging about that, because the view that I'm ultimately nothing, which subliminally means I'm relatively nothing, which subliminally completely disempowers your mind so that you feel your mind cannot conquer whatever your body is obstacle or your mind is, but you still don't really have one, as he said to me. And in that story I told yesterday, you know, in Titanic, that question, you're an American. You don't think you have the mind, that is what you came to. So, and he was right, and years more of being critical, and I'm sure still years more, where I really. So that's Shantideva, you see. So Shantideva says, I'd rather lose my life, give my life, than become filled with hatred and anger. What he means by that is that that hatred and anger would then take over what he really is, which is the infinite continuum of his mind. And that would send him straight to hell, worse than any demon who would kill him, who can only just take his coarse body. And if he lets go of it, if he dies happy, he has a better new body, no problem. And so he actually sees it like that. No, that to him is practical, you understand. It's not like a big self-sacrifice. It's a practical thing. You get it? Because that's the worldview, the real worldview. And when he makes the real worldview for the dualistic Buddhist, the ones who he leaves with some degree of their intrinsic reality habit, because it would be too radical for them, and they would confuse emptiness with nothingness. So he doesn't. He teaches emptiness and selflessness in a course every time, but he doesn't emphasize. So he teaches it in terms of relativity. He says causality. That's my discovery. Because when people then go to that, they accept the view of causality and they really work on going deeper in dealing and seeing everything in terms of causality. What that means is that erodes that center of sense of the central core of being absolutely yourself, which is an unchanging thing disconnected from everything, which is the source of your sickness and suffering and unhappiness and etc. And we've been carrying that beginninglessly on some level of conventional expression. On some other level, we don't actually have it. We just think we can. That's good enough. As Shantideva said, an illusory person suffering is still hope. An illusory person suffering, and an illusory doctor healing the suffering in an illusory manner is helping that illusion to be nicer. And, you know, he said that, remember? So here, then we celebrate this Shakyamuni, and they say that he did teach the Kalachakra at the same time. It was he having melted infinitely. When you melt infinitely into reality, then you are one with the deep, infinite energy of the void, which is what we call clear light, or better, we could call it transparency, which is like infinite energy is what we're all made of, this infinite energy, and everything, the rocks and the earth and everything is infinite energy. And it doesn't do anything. So when you melt into it, you're cool, you don't have to do anything else. In a way, but you are everywhere in it. So then, although you don't have to do anything else, it's also, it's effortless for you to respond to a being suffering who you are the same as, but they don't know that and they're miserable. And you can manifest any embodiment that you want anywhere, out of anything. You can turn anything into anything. You truly are a miracle worker. And you are all of that, everywhere, doing that. So he manifested inside the dome part of the great stupa of Amaravati in South India, which was already there somehow. And inside that, he manifested by the kindness of Manjushri, who was always working, like Avalokiteshvara, Manjushri and Maitreya, they were always working with the Buddha, all the Buddhas. They are Buddhas, being Buddhas. And so Manjushri created to guard the situation inside the stupa, in another dimension, a Yamantaka Mandala, although they never say that word. They say the Dharma realm, Lord of God of the Word, God of Speech. But that's a very terrific type of mandala, in the real meaning of terrific. And creating a completely safe universe. And then within that universe, then Shakyamuni manifested himself as the Lord and Lady Kalachakra, both of them, and not just the one. And then that manifested the entire mandala. He and she together created the whole mangala of all the deities and invited all the Hindu deities, actually, all of them. And the Hindu deities, they invited them they went into the mouth of the Kalachakra, front face, usually, I guess maybe in all the faces, actually, front face, and then down through his central channel into the womb of the Vishwamata, Universal Mother. And then in there, they were reborn as Kalachakra deities, but keeping their continuum as this. And then they were, those 722 deities are all the Hindu deities, and some that we never even heard of. But, some that are not in the normal Vedic pantheon, but are there. And what I love about it, in the speech mandala, and even another, the Mrs. Ganesha is the big deal. Mrs. Kumara, Mrs. Shiva, Mrs. Brahma, Mrs. Vishnu. And the guys are like, okay. They're like being cool. And then they get their own in the body mandala. The males are the center of the different lotuses. There are 12 male lotuses, which are the 12 months of the year, and the 30 days in each lunar month. And then the speech are 64 petals of the navel chakra, which is where the speech goddesses all live. They're all right now in everybody's navel chakra. There are 64 goddesses. Savitri is there. All the Vedic speech goddesses are in there. They have their own palaces in there because they're Kalachakras. But the reason they like the god chakra is they become god chakra. Mm. That's more blissful than the god bliss. Because the god bliss has a slight boundary against it, because it's in heaven, not hell, not in the human realm. It's higher than something. It's not everywhere. It's not a bliss that transforms even hell, which Buddha bliss is. So it's a greater bliss. So then at the same time he taught Kala Chakra. Anyway, here we're celebrating where he taught the many different versions. And you know, Buddha is a strange entity again in the speech level, where a Buddha talks, unlike someone like me or ordinary person that we hear. You know, so Dalai Lama's in a way, he's touching on that. He was very happy and proud of it. He would say, Vietnamese translation, okay. Chinese translation, okay. Japanese translation, okay. French, German, Russian, you know, English. You know, but apparently Buddha doesn't need a bunch of translators. Buddha says one thing, or seems to say one thing, and everybody hears it in their own language automatically. And also, in the days before video and, you know, like TV, everyone thinks Buddha's right in front of them, in a huge 100,000 person. And also, when Buddha's teaching, they don't need a tent, because the humans are in some level here. And then with them, there's the great serpents. There are the Nagas come up from under the ocean, from under the water, and they're there. And there's a huge, like a Lord of the Rings type of array. Also, the gods come. The creator, Brahma, who the other people think is creator, and Shiva and Vishnu, and they're all up there, all their godlings, sometimes the enlightened monks can see them, actually, but most of the people can't see them. So when the thing like, when the Wheel of Dharma turns, all the beings that can come, and even they, even in Mahayana, they have in their sci-fi worldview, the Brahmas of other universes come to this universe, because they can travel between universes. And each one is like the sheriff of their own universe, you know, the Brahma. And the Brahma is his disciple of Buddha. Because Brahma likes Buddhas in his universe. He hopes for the universe to ripen to where Buddhas will come. Because then Buddhas go and tell the beings that Brahma didn't create their suffering. You know, he creates a lot of things, but not their suffering. And that's their own karma. You know? And he likes Buddhas are the ones who really explain that to the beings. So he likes Buddhas and he supports them. He gives them, you know, he's like the videographer for the Buddha. Brahma is, God's coming. So anyway, here though, he told his monks, mainly they were like, so there was one monk called Subhuti who was especially good at it, and Shariputra was always a little worried about it all and not quite getting it, and he's always teasing Shariputra, but he really gets it. But he's always the butt of some sort of his dual, because he always brings up his dualism, Shariputra. So he taught them, he said, I don't want you to spread this teaching for 400 years approximately, he said, and at that time, someone with the name with the word Naga in their name will recover this teaching. And for now, I entrust it to the Nagas, he said. And the Nagas had a huge library, apparently, underwater. And they took Nagarjuna there, according to them. So he gave it to the Nagas. Probably the gods, Maitreya, had the copies in heaven, probably. And a few pirated copies. But basically, he gave it to the Nagas, which people understand all kinds of different ways. Naturally, Westerners think, oh, that's just those Indians lying again. They're not British, and they don't tell the truth. It's a bunch of rude stuff that they're still saying. And because they don't believe that there could be a type of awareness that is aware of things centuries in the future easily. Knows really what's going to happen. And is working to make the better thing happen, not the worst thing happen. And has incredible ability, miraculous ability, to see that happen. And but he said, this is to be esoteric. I don't want it widely spread. People are not ready for it. And it's best that we do this dualistic vehicle and really establish a lot of monasteries, universities. People are allowed to drop out. Women could. He was a little worried about women because he knew they're smarter. And although he didn't let on, because that would have made him unpopular with the men who were dominating in society, he didn't quite let on. He sort of did, but people don't get the hint. And they don't really need to drop out in the same way. And also, if many of them did drop out, he knew they would, because they suffer more because the men make them do all the work. And they boss them around, and they're really bad to them. And any militaristic society will beat up the women. That's just the way that the men become conditioned. And therefore, the elderly has a miserable time because the women get their revenge suddenly in different ways. And so nobody has fun. And they get more and more violent. So So he did, was worried about that, which feminists today get all nervous about. But the reason he said, yeah, they can tell I mean, even easier. But the men of the society in future centuries won't tolerate the women leaving the household where they're doing all the work. And they will come in a few thought. And he was right. And then he opened the door to his ex-wife and his stepmother, who was leading the crowd. It was a stampede. The women just, they wanted out of that household. They totally wanted out, and they just charged right over. Anyway, so this sutra, he said, this is the deep teaching. This is the profound. This is the one, like His Holiness goes on all about it. This is it. And he taught it many different ways. And the long one, he just, you know, he went everything. It's like your toenail is emptiness, your next toenail is emptiness, your hair follicle is emptiness, your pore is emptiness, your femur bone is emptiness, your ankle bone is emptiness, and it just goes on and on. But he always put the qualification. Like in the Heart Sutra, people get misled because there's this long passage where it says no eye, no ear, no nose, no this, no that, right? Basically know everything. After saying, and form is emptiness is a bad translation. It should be matter is emptiness. That's the only thing that delivers the proper non-dual shock. Because when we think form is something, well, the form, you know, but it should be, the reason is that that word rupa is ambiguous, and it can mean a visual object. And so, and visual object is defined in Buddhist science and linguistics and dictionaries as form and color, shape and color. So then people take, in English translators, they take the shape part, and they say form. They don't mention form and color, they just say form. But it's a visual object. But when it's form is emptiness, they don't mean a visual object, they mean matter. You know, you can't see, you know, the wind, you know, but that's matter, you know, energy. And so that's emptiness. And the rock is emptiness. So you have to say matter to make it proper. Someday, they'll, after I die, they will take up that word and they'll give up that form, which is not a right word. So matter is emptiness and emptiness is matter. That's very key. The key, second one is just as key. Matter is emptiness and emptiness itself is matter. That means that you're not getting away from matter. That's what it means. That's not the point. The point is feel you and the matter are all emptiness. And actually in Tantra, matter is Lochana, Buddha Lochana, which means the Buddha eye. And she is a female Buddha in the mind mandala of Kalachakra and with mandala and other things. Her name is Buddha Lochana. And she's also the infinite, immeasurable of love that people do meditation. So matter is love, actually. So when you go to Mount Kailash, you realize that the rocks are love. They are the... And why is it love? Because we are all bunch of chicken littles, every single one of them. We don't want to be hurt. We don't want to be bitten by that cobra. We don't want to be crowded on the mountain here. We don't want to be like that. And we would all be right on the top of the realm of formlessness in neither consciousness or unconsciousness, in bodiless samadhi. And then if we came out of there, we'd rather rush back. Even if we fell to human, we'd be a yogi and we'd get right back. We'd have no body so nobody could hurt us. We'd happily be unconscious. We all totally escapist in a certain deep inner way, fear of suffering. So, Buddhas lure us. Love lures us into having bones and flesh and bodies and bumping into other bodies. Why? Because how can you have compassion unless you interconnect? Unless you feel a little pain too and see their pain, then you become more worried about their pain, then you finally become a Buddha. And then you don't have to disappear and you experience being on a rock as bliss. Like you make love with the rock. Your butt makes love with it, just sitting on it. Not just makes love, it is the fruit of it. It's like complete orgasmic bliss. Just sitting on a rock. That's the goal. And then you want more rocks so that the other beings don't hide in that formless realm, or matterless realm, immaterial realm. And just get stuck there and don't evolve into their true potential fulfillment. So, but then later, after that, matter is emptiness. I like voidness. Matter is voidness, voidness is one syllable less. Matter is voidness, voidness is matter. Matter is not other than voidness, voidness is not other than matter. The same with sensation, conception, volition, and consciousness. you know, that it goes like that, the Heart Sutra. And then it starts out of thing, there's no I, no here, no, no, no. And then that has had a nihilistic interpretation in history, in Buddhist history, not just in the West, in Buddhist history. And the modern materialists, there's a bunch of them in California and all over, to say, oh yeah, he anticipated our wonderful triumphal materialism, where we know that ultimately the universe is nothing, and we're brave existentialists, and we're ready to be nothing, because it takes great courage to be nothing. It takes great courage to be unconscious. That's such an asinine idea. Everybody's dying to be unconscious. Just see, let me pull on your tooth a little bit. Oh, make me unconscious! Quick! They all want it. And they're happily thinking that they won't exist after death. And therefore, when they're faced with a horrible thing, they'll just shoot themselves, thinking they're going into an anesthetic realm. And it's a prison that you do. It's a prison. It means nothing you do positive will really have ultimate effect. So why bother? Make any intensity about doing something positive. That's why it's a prison. I call it the materialist psychological circuit breaker, which means when you have energy building up in you, like you want to blow your top and shout and scream and throw things or shoot somebody or kill somebody, and you're having an impulse to do that, and you want to resist it because you want to be ethical, because you're a good Muslim, you're a good Buddhist, you're a good Christian, you're a good whatever, and you want to resist it, but if you're a materialist, but it gets a little unbearable, that stress, what happens is the circuit breaker goes click, and you think, what the hell? Who cares? Why does it matter? You know, I'm going to have my impulse. And then you just let you become helpless. Your impulse drives you to whatever deed, you know, either lust deed, hate deed, or delusion deed, and you become a fanatic, and you destroy yourself and somebody else. Right? You understand that? Because you don't have, whereas when you know that everything has endless consequence, that you're here for the duration, which is eternal, it's infinite, then you know that if you let yourself go to this inner impulse, then the reactions and the consequences can be far worse than this feeling of having to block your impulse. So you get tremendous power from that awareness to block it and to transmute it. And that's why you can't do Tantra. Tantra is, every hippie wants to do Tantra. Oh, I know it. My Lama Tartuk used to say, being a monk is easy. That's relatively easy. Just you restrain yourself. And you don't run off here and there. You don't look at, they don't watch porn and everything. You don't get all hung up on stuff.